Hello. That got your attention. Good evening, everybody. What a tremendous turnout. We thank every one of you for being here with us to join in celebrating a great basketball program at a phenomenal university, and in particular, to celebrate the 40th year anniversary of the first ACC men's basketball championship in the history of the university. And I think that's worthy of a round of applause for our opportunity to gather. I have the honor of not only making that welcome remark, but also to do something pretty special. I'd like to have everybody get a glass, if you will, because I'm going to offer a toast. And there's a person, or actually a family, whose name is synonymous with Virginia basketball and synonymous with excellence. And for more than 40 years, the Burkhead family has meant something very special to each and every one of us. We're here tonight in part because of an idea that one person had about a year and a half ago, and his idea was to bring many generations of Virginia basketball players, coaches, staff, and friends together to recognize the 1976 team. We're talking about Frank. And in sharing a couple moments with Jackie earlier this afternoon, she wanted me to talk or mention two things. Number one is that for every person in this room and for many that aren't here, Frank loved you guys. He loved each and every one of us because of our DNA, being a part of this program, but for the things that each of us have done, whether we are a fan, a friend of the program, an alumnus, a former player, coach, or just somebody that would hang out with the guys on the team. Frank was an unsung hero. And although he was a guy that was behind the scenes in many ways, there was one thing that he was very upfront about. And he was very upfront, A, about obviously his love for his family, B, his love for Virginia basketball. But he was very upfront about doing whatever he could to make the Virginia basketball program a successful program. And some of you may know, others may not know, that Frank was a little bit superstitious, and I'm sure that he got that from Coach Holland at some point along the line. And for more than 40 years, for the entire time that Frank was connected to this basketball program, again, some of you may know, others may not know, Frank was always willing to bring, quote, the shirt. How many of you know about the shirt? Okay? The shirt. Whenever there was a big game coming up, whenever the program needed that little extra push, a call was placed to Frank, and whether it was in College Park, Maryland, Chapel Hill, Miami, Pittsburgh, Atlanta, you name it, Frank, we need the shirt. Not only was the shirt there, but more importantly, Frank was there. But Frank, being an unsung hero, made contributions in many ways. He made a contribution as a team manager. He made a contribution as an advisor and mentor to coaches and players. He made contributions to this university as a member of the Board of Visitors. But most of all, Frank was a confidant and a friend who served the University of Community and Virginia basketball. And his contributions as the holder, the possessor of the shirt, certainly have played a significant role in the history and the success of the University of Virginia basketball program. So I would ask that you join with me tonight in a toast for a person who started this conversation about this reunion, this gathering of so many special people to the University of Virginia and the basketball program. This is a guy who was the epitome of a Virginia gentleman. So I would ask you to raise a glass and toast of, and Jackie, if you'll come and join me. To Frank Burkhead and to the Burkhead family. Okay. Thank you. I'm going to give one more thank you, and then I'm going to turn it over to our host and the person who will take us through the next part of the program. We have a lot of people that did great work in setting up this program tonight. The Virginia Athletics Foundation staff, and I'd ask if you would give them a round of applause, VAF. They're right over there. And there was a core of former players that over the course of several months on a number of conference calls and meetings, and actually they took place over the course of about a year, but Ralph, Jimmy, Tom Baker, Wally Walker, Dirk Kastra, and I might be missing somebody, but thanks to our former players who were a big part of the planning for this evening. Thank you guys. I want to thank Coach Bennett and the team for the work that they did out here today, the work that they do every day to represent this program. We thank you also for being here tonight. Tony, Laurel, appreciate you guys and the support that you've shown to the former players. And most importantly, the sponsor of our bar, the Ridley Scholars Program, and our colleagues from Ridley Scholars. A round of applause for them and the sponsoring of the bar. Thank you. I'm going to turn it over to our host for the next part of the program, and a guy that not only is a former player and a great friend of the program, but you may recognize him, or possibly, if you don't recognize him, recognize his voice. He's been a color analyst for college basketball for many, many years now. He's done college baseball, but one of the all-time great guys, Mr. Dan Bonner. Dan.
Okay, now part of the problem for me with an event like this is there are a lot of people in this room who know that I know nothing about basketball. And my reputation is as some big expert. So those of you who know, just keep your thoughts to yourselves. I'm talking about you, Bob McKay. Anyhow, the reason that we are here tonight is to honor the 1976 ACC championship team and the coaching legacy of Terry Holland. And the best way to get that started is to show the 1976 ACC championship video, which I'm promised is 7 minutes and 38 seconds long. So, where's the video? I don't have a button up here. Okay.
This is it, the finals. What the ACC tournament is all about. The Cavaliers had never gotten past the second round of the tournament. Yet here they are going against tournament tough and highly favored North Carolina. In the midst of playing in their fourth ACC tournament, seniors Mitch Kupchak and Wally Walker have their own personal feelings surrounding the big game.
I'll never forget the ACC. It's been amazing, the crowds and the fans, and there seems to be that mist in the air that you just can't define or you can't pick out. It's always there, and it's great. It's a great feeling.
You know, maybe if I was finished regular season in first place, maybe I wouldn't be so anxious to go out and play the tournament because, you know, I could jeopardize my ACC championship, but as it is now, I look forward to it and have another crack at that championship.
Virginia has gotten its chance the hard way. They know if they are to win, they must control the tempo. They must play their game. Patient. Poised. Ready to take advantage. Midway through the first half, Carolina runs off 8 unanswered points. But the Cavaliers begin to regain their form behind the inside play of Castellan, Walker, and Ivoroni. Later, with Kupchak on the bench with 3 personals and the Tar Heels holding a slim 2-point lead, Wally Walker begins to find the range. He drives Virginia into the lead. With only 2 seconds left in the first half, Billy Langlaw tosses a perfect pass to Otis Fulton, who scores at the buzzer. Virginia is rolling. The upstart underdogs are doing it again. Having been down 8, they've shocked the Tar Heels, taking a 35-30 lead into the locker room. And this Virginia team may be able to pull off the biggest 3-day surprise in ACC history.
This next stretch right here is really important to us. Every single possession, ours and theirs.
Virginia must get back to its game and take Carolina's away. They go to the hoop and are there if the shot misses. They get the ball inside. The Cavaliers are controlling the game's tempo, slowing the Heels down, causing them to shoot from a little further out. Virginia's big men are working together as the Cavaliers come back. Their determined hustling is scoring points. All-American Phil Ford continues his excellent play, but with 4 minutes left, Virginia has tied the game at 60 all. Neither team can score as both squander chances to take the lead. The pressure mounts. Something must give. With 34 seconds left, a foul is called, sending Billy Langlaw to the line for a 1-and-1. Pressure. Everyone feels it, but Langlaw calmly makes both shots. Virginia leads by 2. North Carolina can tie. But Walker shuts off Davis. Kuster fakes a shot, then sees an opening. But a whistle. Traveling is called. Virginia ball. The Tar Heels press. Ivoroni inbounds to Langlaw. He penetrates the middle and spots Otis Fulton wide open. Virginia leads 64-60. North Carolina calls time with 15 seconds left to set up a play. Davis drives the baseline where Walker and Ivoroni cut him off. The Tar Heels lose possession and are forced to foul Langlaw again. Virginia now by 5. Langlaw misses the second. Davis gets the ball, drives, and Virginia lets him shoot. The lead is cut to 3 with less than 10 seconds to play. Langlaw is fouled immediately. Two perfect shots would ensure the most important victory in Virginia basketball history. Makes them both. One last Tar Heel desperation pass fails. The Virginia Cavaliers have done it, 67-62. To claim the crown, they had to upset each of the three top-seeded teams. Never before had this been done. Playing their finest consistent basketball of the season, Virginia had made believers of everyone. 3 days of grueling competition, 3 days of exhausting exertion, 3 days of psychologically draining pressure. All of this is rewarded tonight. Billy Langlow, Mark Ivoroni, and Wally Walker join North Carolina's Mitch Kupchak and Phil Ford and Duke's Tate Armstrong on the all-tournament team. And Wally Walker is named the most outstanding player. Virginia's victory did prove once again the Atlantic Coast Conference Tournament is the most frenzied, unpredictable 3 days of pressure basketball anywhere. For Virginia, it was a night to celebrate.
It's hard to imagine it's been 40 years. Now, you heard Coach Littlepage talk about the fact that they had a number of conference calls leading up to this thing, and I understand that Wally lobbied very hard for some digital editing to make the shorts longer. So they weren't able to do that, but Wally, I did notice that they managed some digital editing. You remember the part about where he guarded somebody? So that's edited in there. I don't think that ever really happened. But I now want to recognize the members of that 1976 team that are here in attendance tonight. And as I call your name, I'd like you please to stand up and be recognized. The players who are here, Bob Stephson. Wally Walker. Mark Newland. Ed Shetlick. Steve Castellan. Otis Fulton. Bobby Stokes. Manager, Rusty Cleveland. Manager, Phil Beeson. Assistant coach, Brian Tully. Assistant coach, Mike Schuler. Trainer, Craig Johnson. Head athletic trainer, Joe Geek. And of course, the head coach of the 1976 Cavaliers, Terry Holland. Now, obviously, Coach Holland had a tremendous impact on that 1976 team, and just as obviously, an enormous impact on the Virginia basketball program. Over 16 years, from 1974 through 1990, Coach Holland won 326 games, guided the Cavaliers to postseason play 13 times. His team won the NIT championship in 1980, went to two Final Fours in 1981 and 1984, and obviously he's the winningest coach in UVA basketball history. Tonight, we have the opportunity to honor Coach Holland and his coaching legacy at the University of Virginia. And to help us, we're going to have a little panel discussion. And we've asked three former players and a former assistant coach to come up here and participate with us in the panel discussion. The first member of our panel, the most valuable player of the 1976 ACC Championship, and somebody who put on one of the most, if not the most spectacular performance ever in the ACC tournament in 1976, Wally Walker. Also on our panel, the three-time National Player of the Year and four-time All-American, Ralph Sampson. Member of that 1984 Final Four team and the current head coach of the Dallas Mavericks, Rick Carlisle. Rick, we only have until 7:55. And a longtime assistant under Coach Holland and the head coach in his own right at Wake Forest in South Carolina, Dave Odom. Now, before we complete our panel, I would be remiss if I didn't recognize one other person who had an awful lot to do with that 1976 championship team, the guy who hired Coach Holland to coach at Virginia. Now, all his hires weren't quite so successful. This man also hired me to coach the women's team, and that didn't really work out so well. I want to introduce to you Gene Corrigan. And the final member of our panel, of course, Coach Terry Holland. Yeah, you gotta come up here. Now, did you see that look Coach Holland gave me as he was walking up here? Anybody who's ever played for Coach Holland has seen that look before. In 1975, when Coach Holland must have felt like he somehow landed on the Isle of Misfit Toys, he coached a team on which I played. We had a game at Davidson in the old Charlotte Coliseum. It was not a good game, but it was tied at the end, and Coach Holland called a timeout. Wally had fouled out of the game, and Coach Holland set up the final play. And in his desperation, he diagrammed a play where the ball was supposed to go to me. Now, things didn't quite work out the way he planned, as is wont to do in the course of a basketball game, but somehow the ball actually ended up in my hands. I threw in a turnaround jump shot from the corner, it went in the basket, and we won the game. Now, I was so thrilled that Coach Holland had the confidence in me to call that final play to go to me. I went up to him after the game, and I thanked him. And I said, Coach, you don't know what it means to me that you had confidence that I would make that shot. And he gave me that deadpan look that if he didn't invent it, he at least perfected it. And he said to me, I never imagined that you would make the shot. I was just hoping they would foul you and maybe you would make one of the free throws. So that is part of Coach Holland's legacy, knowing how to really build up the confidence of his players. He once described Wally Walker as his best outside shooter, but then explained that we played indoors. So, Wally, how are you able to deal with that?
You know, that joke just gets funnier by the year, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. It's 40 years old.
Yeah. He actually made me 42. That's before he even coached me, he said. You want me to say something more?
Yeah.
The Penn's a senior year.
Not about me.
Yeah, it's all about you. We play in the ACC tournament. We're 12-12. I don't know how we're 12-12 because we're not very good. By the way, our schedule that year was rated the second toughest in the country. But we're 12-12, won in the ACC tournament first round. We're playing NC State. You guys remember NC State, some of you. Defending champion, player of the year, ACC player of the year, number one pick in the NBA draft, David Thompson. That's our first round opponent. So we do what everyone expected. We go down 20. We're down 20 and a half. What happens? We come back the second half. I actually have an open shot. Maybe it wasn't that open, but I had a shot in the corner. I can't remember if it was to tie or to win it. It was late in the game. I miss it. But it was a great comeback. We go back to the locker room. We're 12-13. We have a losing season. Coach Holland gathers around and looks at us and says, very proud of what you guys did here in that second half. You showed a lot of people what you can do. And next year, we're going to be back here playing for and winning this ACC championship. We look around the locker room. Andrew Benenni talked about it earlier. Penns remembers it. They were the seniors on that team, Brian Tully. And we're kind of looking at each other like, what's Coach got in his Gatorade? What's going on with that kind of comment? But he could tell us later whether he meant it. But as I said in Jerry's column today, if he didn't mean it, he made us believe that he meant it and showed the confidence and planted the seed that a year later germinated. We never considered, given 12-13 and where we were, we could be a contender to be a ranked team and win the ACC championship next year. But a year before, the confidence that he showed and demonstrated the leadership, the way he articulated it, was the first step to our going.
Now, Ralph, let me ask you. Obviously, you had a great career here, and Coach Holland was clearly a big part of it. Tell us one of your best memories of Coach Holland. So you have the last word.
Now, first of all, let me pay tribute to, I know it's a 76-team reunion, but there's some guys I played with here, I'd like to stand up. When I first got to the hotel, the first person I saw was Lee Raker. And we go way back. I remember Coach Holland always put Lee and Terry Gates here. We've got to stand up. Say, you know, you get in trouble. Terry Gates always beat people up. And Lee Raker was the nastiest SOB on the court. So we knew that. And I was telling my lovely fiance that we played Maryland one game. And Lee remembered that. And they had Ernest Graham. He took the ball out of bounds. And Ernest had did something dirty during the course of the game at University Hall. And Lee took the ball and just smacked him upside the face. On the out-of-bounds play, remember that play? So you got to stand up. There's Kent Leland back there, Jimmy Miller, and then play with Richard Morgan. He's here. Todd Kersey is a part of the team as well. So these guys are here that I played with, and, you know, college play of the year, whatever, doesn't mean too much to me anymore. It's in my mother's house in the basement collecting dust. But playing with these guys and coming to Virginia with Coach Holland was very important that these guys are part of my life, so I thank you guys for being here as well. And then we go along with that. But some memories, we go way back from Jock Glock to Hawaii to one of the worst losses ever in Virginia basketball history. But it created the Maui class, which Coach Holland talked about as well. That, so if I had to lose a game and it created a Maui class, is now what, 30 some years old, I guess I'll take that loss a little bit, not much. So. The foundation, though, of UVA basketball, but Barry Parker was back there as well. He kind of laid the foundation early on, so I don't know if you know Barry, but he don't like to be recognized either, but Barry Parker was back there. I mean, Dave Cook is back there. Dave Cook and his dad, the cleaners, you know, Dave Cook is there, so his son, and Dave played here as well, so he's here. So you got people like that are the fiber of Virginia basketball. And that's the reason we I think, are here today, because it goes deeper than just basketball. You know, when I first came to Virginia, And Coach Allen says, I know Miss Allen would say the same thing, his car was on automatic pilot to Harrisonburg every day. And they were there quite often. And I was recruited by, you know, everybody from that standpoint. But the memories go back when I came to UVA on my recruiting trip. You had 48 hours. We took a helicopter ride over to University Hall. Tommy Hicks wrote Ralph's House on University Hall, et cetera. But it was the weekend of my mother's birthday. It was the worst college visit I had in the four that I took. No, they had donuts that were, Coach Faith had them, they were stale in the car. So that's kind of a joke. But we drove over, we went back, we came back, and it was, you know, a good visit after that. But the memories are vast. I could stay here all day long and talk about Coach Allen. And my second mother sits over there. Look at her. And so we go way, way back. But the best thing I can say about the fiber of University of Virginia basketball is that this guy over here is like my second father. My father is 80 years old. He's doing wonderfully well. I came back to Virginia to take care of him. But when I look at Coach Holland, and not just basketball, because basketball is basketball. Basketball is over in 4 years. We all go and do great things. But to come back and honor him in this way was Frank's dream. I talked to Frank many times about this moment. And unfortunately, Frank is looking down upon us, and Mr. Burkhead as well. But to come back and honor and have Joe Geek and Sue Halstead not here, but Dr. Frank McHugh's wife is here, so she raised her hand, because they took care of all of us. I've gotten my knee injuries, and you go to their house, they take care of you. And it was a great moment. Mr. Stokes is here, you know, he's there with Bobby and Ricky and that whole, so we all become a family and go from there. But the fiber of UVA basketball, and today with Coach Bennett, and I tell people all the time, UVA, you better get your shit right, because that guy right there is the real deal. And I appreciate him because he carries a very high standard, and his wife and his family, a very high standard that is UVA basketball. So Coach, I really appreciate what you have done, continued success, no matter what you do and how it goes on. But you better get it right, because he's really, really good. You have recognized, and he's special. So I give him a lifetime contract. Coach, can I be agent? So give him a lifetime contract to stay here. He's good. So other than that, so the memories go on and on and on. But the greatest one is Coach Holland coming to Harrisonburg, and then me actually graduating from here, because I had a chance to go to the NBA out of high school. And every year I come back and say, were my parents okay? Were, you know, I was being coached by a great coaching staff, and was I happy? And all those came to light. The last thing I'll mention is, where are my two sisters at? They standing over there. So one's on a crutch on the foot. I don't know where she's at, but she broke her foot over there. So it's funny because I came here and her daughter is here somewhere. So I took a picture with Aaron Michael on my shoulder some in the university also, and she still has that. I have the picture. Now I'm able to take a picture with her daughter. So I thank them for coming as well. They're very special to me. We talk every now and then and often. So girls, I love you. And Coach Allen, I love you. And I'm glad to be here and honor you, because it's really about you.
I'm gonna follow these two guys.
Well, Rick, there probably are a few people that Ralph didn't recognize, so you'll have to do that.
There are a few I do want to point out. Dr. Joe May was a great friend of ours. Jimmy Graves, Graves Mountain Lodge. Phil Wendell, great friend of ours, big supporter of UVA basketball. There are many, many. I think Ralph mentioned Barry Parkhill, and so many more. Was there a question for me? Or?
Yeah, there was.
Freestyle.
Yeah, there was. There was. Obviously.
You're gonna ask me about,
I'm going to ask you something. Well, obviously, you have had tremendous success in your own right as a coach. And so tell us your story, but also...
Not so much as a player.
Well, player, you know, you guys, what? You went to the Final Four when nobody expected it. I think that's pretty good. But tell us what you learned from Coach Holland, and then tell us your story.
Well, Coach Holland was a master psychologist. I also want to mention Dr. Bob Rotella and his wife, Verlaine. Doc Rotella was a big part of our run to the Final Four in 1984. In fact, you know, we had a bunch of head cases on that team, myself included. And we got into this groove as we finished the regular season and we got a tournament bid. And we had these sessions where we would meet, I think, 3 hours before the game. And Doc had us all laying down on the floor, closing our eyes, and visualizing, you know, how we were going to beat that opponent that we were, you know, heavy underdogs against that particular night. And we rode Doc Rotella all the way to the Final Four that year. And I want to tell one other story about Coach Holland. Yeah, my first ACC game was on the road at Duke. You know, and I transferred here. And one thing I just want to say about this group of people and about, you know, the Virginia basketball family in general, you know, I as a transfer, you know, you come in here as more or less an outsider. It's not like being here from the very beginning. And the thing that was most special about my experience was how, you know, welcoming people were, and they accepted me like I was a full four-year student, you know, and I always appreciated that. But we played our first game at Duke, and, you know, I'd been playing at the University of Maine, so, you know, we would show up to places, and we'd be out there shooting around before the game, hour and a half before the game, and we'd be lucky if there was, you know, 50 or 100 people in there. And the entire Duke building was packed with people, and these people, I had no idea they even knew who I was. They were yelling out snide remarks about the University of Maine and all this other stuff. It was, like, unbelievable. And thanks to Ralph, who, by the way, you know, a lot of us owe our careers and lives to what he did here. I mean, if there was no Ralph Sampson at Virginia, I doubt very much there would be a building like this sitting here. So thank you for everything you did. Coach Odom and I were saying that, you know, I was here for 2 years with Ralph. He was here for two or three. He said he talked more in the last, when he just had the microphone, than he did in 2 years. But anyway, so we played Duke, and they were young at the time. So we win the game, and I had a good game, and, you know, and so we came in the next day to practice, and we're getting ready to play Georgetown in the biggest game in the history of college basketball. And I believe we played them 2 days later, and then we were off to Japan or something like that. So I thought, hey, you know, we won our first game on the road. You know, I had a good game. A lot of guys played well. I bet, you know, it'd be a real positive day in practice. So coach comes down, and he is all over us. And he said to me, he goes, and this is like, you know, and I was like in shock. He goes, Rick Carlisle, I don't know what you think you're doing out here today, but you, the way you guarded those guys in Duke, you got no chance in hell guarding these guys against Georgetown. And he created an environment for a practice that we had to have, you know, to have any chance against Georgetown because of their tenacity, athleticism, and everything else. He worked us into an absolute froth that day. And it manifested in, you know, it was really one of the most intense games I ever remember being part of. And of course, we won by 5 or 6 points. And so the other story I want to tell was that, you know, these guys had me down here for a visit when I was transferring. And Jim Larrañaga was mostly responsible for this. And, you know, Larrañaga's not here, but Larrañaga's, you know, a little wacky guy, a little crazy. And so what these guys did was, I came down, and it was, you couldn't try a guy out in those days. And I've never talked to you about this, but I believe that this happened. A pickup game was organized. You know, these guys said, hey, you want to play pickup? And Raker was here, and Ralph was out there, and Ophel Wilson, and JJ, and Lamp wasn't there. He was gone somewhere. We had the whole Virginia number one ranked team in the country out there playing a pickup game with me, and I was like, wow, this is unbelievable. And I think back on it, and the first thing that came to my mind was, wow, these guys are unbelievable. It'd be unbelievable to have a chance to play with a guy like Ralph, Ophel, all these guys. Well, I think what was happening was these guys were reporting back to Coach Holland as to whether they should offer me a scholarship or not. And so I'm not accusing him of being a Machiavellian type, you know, personality, but my experience here was phenomenal, as was, you know, all of ours. And, you know, every time there's been one of these reunion get-togethers, it's been during the throes of the NBA season, so I've never been able to get back. So I appreciate the committee, and I know Jim Miller was a big part of it. Tim Mullen was involved a little bit. Wally, for having it at a time where all of us could get back.
Thank you, Rick. Now, Coach Odom, you have known Coach Holland for as long as anybody, and one of the things that I think made Coach Holland such a great coach is his competitiveness. And I noticed by that scar on your face that you're still competitive. So maybe you could tell us a story about Coach Holland and his competitive nature.
Well, he is, among other things, very competitive. He's a lot of other things, too, some of them I don't want to talk about right now. Let me pick up on a couple of stories that, Ralph kind of started it by mentioning Chaminade. Rick kind of mentioned it a little bit in passing. There's a lot more to that trip than either one of them talked about. Let me kind of fill in the blanks, if you would. Rick was right. We started that week playing down in Durham. I think it was the first ever three-point line that cut the old line that cut through the center circle or the free throw line. Yeah, okay. So we're down there and we're playing and we beat the fire out of them, as Rick said. Then we get on the bus and we come back to Charlottesville. 2 days later, we go up to Washington and we're playing in what was billed as, I think Sports Illustrated called it, the Battle of the Twin Towers. Obviously, Ralph and Patrick Ewing. And we play that game. Neither team played great, but we won the game. Everybody's happy. We're ready to get on a plane the next morning. Big snowstorm comes in. We can't get out, so we got a bus up to Kennedy Airport, was it? I think. Wasn't it? I think it was. Jimmy Miller.
Don't worry about the details, Dave. Just go.
It makes for a good story. Jimmy Miller said, I'm right. So we bus up to New York, and it must be right. And we get on the plane, we fly to Tokyo. We get over to Tokyo, and everybody is worn out. It's a 15-hour trip. We stopped in Anchorage just a few minutes and, get fuel, and then we go on to Tokyo. We get over there, we go to the first practice, just shoot around, got to play in another day. We get up the next morning, Jock Doc's with us, he's a doctor, and we get up the next morning, and Jock Doc slips in at pregame meal, and he whispers to Terry, Ralph's not going to play. I said, what? Ralph's not going to play. He's dehydrated. He can't play. You got to be kidding me. We're getting ready to play Houston. I thought we played them first. Okay. We're getting ready to play the Phi Slamma Jamma Houston crowd. And we're one in the country, and they're maybe, I don't know, three or four, something like that. But Ralph's not going to play. Terry and I are sitting on the bench before the game. Jim Larranaga's on the other side. And here comes one of those Japanese guys behind, and they said, Samson must play. Terry says he can't. The doctor said he can't play. Samson must play. Look up here. Everybody comes to see Samson, and they're all those little Japanese flags and just kind of waving them at us. So Terry leans over to me and says, ask him if you take him to Ralph in the hotel, will he be satisfied? And so through an interpreter, I said to the guy, look, we'll just to prove it, we'll take you to the hotel. He's got IVs in. We'll take Jock Doc with us. We'll go over there, and that, that'll suffice. So we get over there, and the guy says, he must come to the arena. And he takes his black bag, and he empties out every Sony mechanism that you can find, watches and rings and everything. Samson can have all of these if he comes to the arena. So Ralph somehow or another unplugs everything. We get up and we go over to the arena. He walks in the arena. Everybody sees him and they give him a standing ovation. He waves at him and went back to the hotel. He's never been not on time since. You got the good watches over here. So we went in those two games, and then we head to Hawaii. Had the best practice I think I've ever been to. And we're in Hawaii, in Honolulu. Next day we play Chaminade. and Ralph's high school teammate, rival, was on the other team, on the Chaminade team. We played the game. We had Frank and Jesse James as the two referees. We all know that. And we played the game, and somehow or another, we managed to lose. The only guy in the locker room that would talk to the media was Rick Carlisle. He hadn't done it that much. He was a transfer, and so he wanted to talk to me. And he was our lead spokesman that night, so he did that. So the next morning, we get to the airport, and we're going to fly back to Charlottesville. Terry and I are sitting over in the far corner over there, and Rich Murray, who was our SID at the time, comes over. He says, look, the TV people want to talk to Terry. I said, really? I said, yeah, TV people want to talk to Terry. So I lean over and I said, Terry, you're going to have to go talk to the TV people. I ain't going. I said, Terry, you talk to them when you win. You got to talk to them when you lose. I ain't going. He said, just tell them. He said, I'm not going. Besides that, what happened last night is so preposterous. When the news gets back to Charlottesville, they won't believe it anyway, so to hell with it.
Wally, now, I know that when Mr. Corrigan was going through the hiring process to find a new basketball coach before your junior year, that you got to talk to some of the candidates. And did you get to talk to Coach Holland?
I did.
And how did the first impression square with what you ended up with?
It was a Saturday morning. It was a big spring weekend. Billy Langland and I came in to Mr. Corrigan's office, and there was Coach Holland. Davidson had beaten us that year in a terrible game for UVA faithful, where we somehow had the ball for the last possession and didn't get a shot off. So I'm sure Coach Holland was sitting there thinking, I got some work to do here, and he did. But he was so genial, and we were taken aback that based on what he'd seen the previous game, the previous year, he wanted to come coach us, and one thing led to another, and of course, what we know now is he was the perfect guy.
Ralph, obviously you guys played in some big games. Coach Odom talked about one of them, that game against Georgetown. But obviously they were bigger games, conference games, games in the Final Four. Tell us something about Coach Holland before a basketball game. I don't mean at practice, I mean in the locker room before the game.
Well, I mean, we wasn't in this building for sure. We had the little locker room in University Hall that was regular and quaint, but we all played. But I think you could tell when we were ready to play, when we wasn't ready to play. And so, you know, big games, one of the reporters asked me today that, you know, people knew when they came to University Hall that you had to really play. And, you know, the crowd and the students and the fans, there wasn't any role that you could get up. I mean, the fire marshal could have came in and probably shut it down, but he had the innate ability to just get us up and ready to play. He knew when we weren't ready, he knew when we were ready. So, you know, it could be a North Carolina game, it could have been a Duke game, whatever it was. But he had the ability to push the right buttons. And so one story goes way back, my senior year, he pulled me into the office. And, you know, I was, and Bobby and Lee and guys can understand, Jimmy and them know this, Tim Mullen. You know, we used to run a mile across the street, down through the path, through the runway there. And it's like, now you're like, why would you do that? Because you could twist your ankle, right? But we didn't think about Coach Allen used to run every day. And so we did that, but they would go out, and by the time they were headed back, I was halfway there. So I never liked to run 3 miles, but I think they remember that. But they always run with me. But he put me in his office, I remember this, whatever, my senior year, and said, you know, I was trying to get everybody motivated to play. I had come back, decided to come back to school. They said, you know, remember when you were the freshman, and you had these guys, and you had to motivate them. So he had the ability to take that to the locker room as well. So every game, I think, was a different motivational moment for him, because we were really, really we were good. I didn't realize that until now. We were really a good team. I mean, you take a Kent Eagling now with a walk-on that makes the team. He blocks shots, he rebounds, he played tough defense. So he knew how to move pieces. Othell Wilson, they didn't recruit until his
senior year at the state championship in the University Hall. And he's coming from kind of nowhere and becomes one of our starting point guards. So he had that ability to motivate you on and off the basketball floor that became part of your culture, part of your life. So and every game was different. After my freshman year, every game was different. We won NIT, we were ranked number one in the country for so many weeks. We played, I think I only lost 23 games in my career here, most of them my freshman year. And so he had the ability to keep it at a very high level for 4 years that I was here.
Rick, let me ask you, did you pick up anything about stomping your feet and yelling at the officials that you've been able to carry over into the NBA?
I've been fined over $100,000.
You know, I had one particularly bad incident that was a little beyond what Coach Shalin did. We were playing against Oklahoma City one night, and Russell Westbrook stole the ball and went down and dunked the heck out of it. And the ball bounced over toward our bench. And I don't know if you would have actually done this or not. but I kicked the ball. And I was pissed. Yeah. I thought I was trying to kick it to myself. Well, it went off the side of my foot. And it went about six rows over my owner's head and hit a seven-year-old boy in the face. And, you know, it turned out the kid was a great fan. The dad was really cool. You know, we were able to work through it. But it was a little more complicated than that because about 5 days later, I got an email from one of our ticket salespeople that said, Rick, I need to talk to you about something that happened when you kicked the ball. And I called the guy, and I said, look, we took care of that. I mean, we took him on a tour of the locker room before a game, and I said, well, no, it's Lou Ann Hicks, who was the ex-wife of the Stars owner. The ball hit off the kid's face and hit her in the back of the head, and now she's complaining about headaches and neck pain. And so anyway, it took a while to work through that one, too. But have you ever kicked a ball?
Many times, but only in practice. Just
only in practice. But no, the way that he would stamp his foot and clap to get the referee's attention. Yes, I do that.
Coach Odom. Anything. You have the floor, my friend.
All right, I got it.
That's a dangerous thing.
Listen, there's so many stories in this room right here. I mean, we could pass the mic down every row. It'd be a great story about University of Virginia basketball particularly Coach Allen. I see one over in the corner over there, Richard Morgan. Richard, raise your hand. Most of you will remember that fateful night. It was one of those nights where Terry was not feeling his best, and he was in Martha Washington Hospital, was it? You were in the hospital? Where? Martha Jefferson. Martha Jefferson. I knew it was Martha somebody. He was in the hospital, and he reluctantly turned the reins over to Craig Littlepage. Where's Paige? To Paige, to Jeff Jones, and myself. I think we're the three. And one of the things that we were getting ready to play the University of North Carolina here in University Hall that night. National TV. Terry was sick. He was out of commission, but. You know, that always, when a head coach is out, you know, everybody else wants to do a little more to try to make up for it. So, you know, we did our best to talk to the team and try to get them ready. And one of the things about playing North Carolina was you always wanted to try to trick Dean if you could and his staff. You always wanted to do that. And anytime you beat him, the first thing you do is you got to find Dean because he'll get lost and he won't shake your hand. So, you know, Paige and I, and Jeff Jones, we said before the game, we're kicking their butts tonight. Now, I'm telling you that. We're getting it done. And we're going to find Dean. We're going to make him shake our hand. And everybody's going to go home happy. All the Wahoos, we'll go home, blah, 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 and everything else. And so we played well, thankfully, thanks to the guy over in the corner. Richard, how many did you score that night? I know you know, don't tell us. 39 points. We didn't call a single play for him either. He just kept saying, "Coach, feed me the ball, I'm hot." Just keep doing it. Of course, I saw him one night when I was recruiting over in Salem, and he hit like 39. He ran by, and he was giving everybody on the front row high fives. But Richard, he had a great game that night. I mean, it was terrific. And with about 20 seconds left in the game, we had the game sewed up. And I turned, and it was a timeout, TV timeout, something, I don't know. And Paige and I and Jeff Jones got together, and we assigned each other jobs. And all of this was in Terry's honor. And my job was to find Dean and make him shake my hand. And everybody in the ACC knew that Bill Guthridge's the faithful assistant for Dean for 40 years. His job on the road was as soon as the horn sound, he sprinted to the locker room to get the locker room open before the team got there so they wouldn't get caught up in the visitor crowd. And I turned to Paige and I said, "You got him?" He said, "I got him. Don't worry about it." So as soon as the horn goes off, Paige shot off of that bench as hard as he could go to the tunnel where the visiting team had to go out. And here comes Bill Guthridge running down there. By this time, I'd lassoed Dean and made him shake my hand and JJ's hand. And there was Paige standing there. Did you see it? Right there. He made Bill Guthridge run over him. So after the game, we go up to see Terry. And Terry said, "Did the plan go as usual?" He said, "I know it didn't, because Morgan got 39. He'd have never got that if I was there." I said, "Yeah, but we got a charge on Guthridge." That's the truth. Oh, you want it? I got more stories.
Now, with this group, we could sit here and tell stories all night, but we do have a schedule we're trying to keep, and so what I would like, Wally, for you to start out doing is, as we wind up here, you and I had talked earlier today, you wanted to make sure that everybody ended with something that they wanted to say about Coach Holland. So the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all to be here. So many contributors, as Ralph said, to the success of this program. And so meaningful, the people in this room go way back. I looked at the deputies here I haven't seen in many years in support of this program from back in the 70s. Coach Connor is here, recruited many of us that are here tonight, too. One thing I do want to say, we watched that ACC video and the shorts didn't grow. But even a bigger upset, which I think they called historic on the video or something, but even a bigger upset than that win was me getting voted the team's best defensive player, besides what you said, after my senior year. Now, I don't know who voted. I have a feeling there are some hanging chads in that vote somewhere. But I was voted the top defensive player in the 76 team. Now, Coach Connor, Coach Shuler, I think, are twitching back there because they can't believe it. But that gets to my point. This man over here, Coach Holland, demanded, made me become a defensive player. To say I was indifferent before he got here would be an understatement. Coaches can nod their heads in affirmation. But he demanded that of me, he demanded that of all of us. He made me, he made all of us better players, and he made us better men. We owe him a ton, and it's so great to be here in front of you, his peers, his family, his friends, to be able to say that to him after all these years. Coach, thank you.
You know, my personal opinions all go back to what Wally said, and what we all feel about Coach Holland. You know, Bobby and everybody in here played for him, or Coach Wisdom, we have the same sentiments. And when this started with Frank, so I'd like to thank Mr. Burke Eglis. I know we go back to, I call it Frank's dream. I've talked to Frank many times before this happened, and met him at Starbucks on After Mountain, and we talked about it, and it all came together. So I thank you guys for coming and being a part of it, because it's very special to us, but I know it's special to Coach Holland as well. And I will tell you, and I said in the meeting with Coach LePage and Wally and the crew as well, you know, to me, after basketball, because it's special, in my mind, it's special in your heart. You play to win, you play to your best ability, you play to the highest level. But basketball ends sooner or later. And what does it all mean to you as you look at it? Look at my trophies in my parents' house, and they collected dust, like a Hall of Famer. And it's there, it's a great award, but it's collecting dust. But the relationships you build, Mike Mallory says that we go way back to Michigan, even to today, and Phil and everybody else. So the memories you have, the camaraderie you share, the wars you went into, and the games mean a lot. So this memory, I would hate for it to stop. I would hate for it to not continue in a special way. After I'm leaving this earth, we all whatever, it should still carry on. So I beg of everybody here to find a way to commemorate that guy right there in a special way. Showing up here is just a start. It's not the end, trust me when I say that. It's a start of something special that will leave a legacy here that when that guy goes there and starts to recruit, because I know what he can do, that players come in and see, like Rick said, that we're all here together as a family. What made him come here, I think. He saw Lee Raker or Jeff Lamb or Bobby Stone. He saw his play. I know the rules have changed a lot in NCAA, but you damn sure better understand the foundation and the core of what's in the future. Because that guy right there has got it right. I keep saying that as well, but I want to make sure that I say it as well, because today's market's different. What's going on in Charlotte, what's going on in this world is totally different than when we grew up. And so it's different, basketball is different, Rick knows, and the NBA is different than when we played it, Wally was there as well. So I'll say you find ways to make sure if it's his name on the court, statue out front, whatever. I'll say this, and I'll say it very sincerely. I'm not going to do it when he dies. I'm not going to be here when he passes away. I guarantee you that. So don't call me when he passes, we're going to put a statue out there. That should be done today. And I know she knows it over there. You can say what you want. I know you say whatever you want to say when you want to say it. But it's okay. I love her to death. But I'm just saying, to build that family camaraderie, the culture that Coach Page and the administration, Coach Bennett, wants to build, we want to win an national title, right? I know you do. Every day. And so to do that here is going to be special for all of us. Because we went. We didn't win it. We went. Well, all of us have great stories, but the next thing to this program is to win a national title basketball wise. But as he has done and proven, he's built a program here that's pretty damn good over the years. We all know that. Bill knows it. We all know that. So continued success. Let's win a national title. Let's put a statue out there or name on the court. Whatever you want to do to commemorate this guy here.
I'm going to stand for this one. I want to mention something that's, you know, when you get into coaching, a thing that's not talked about a whole lot, but it's such a huge part of who you become as a coach is who you're married to. I'm going into my 15th year of head coaching in the NBA, and my wife has been such a big part of my development into who I am. Mrs. Holland has been an enormous part of Terry's success, and I know that they have always done this and viewed this as a team thing, you know. And so we're mentioning her a little bit, but I just want to say thank you, because in large part because of you, he is as special as he's become as a person. And I know one thing about Coach Allen, you know, Final Four appearances, Coach of the Year, you know, a lot of wins, all that stuff is important. But what's fulfilling to him, that's success. But fulfillment is the people in this room and the relationships build up over a period of, you know, 40 years. That's really, really special. So, well, thank you, Mrs. Holland, and thank you for.
I know we're running short on time. Let me try to run through a couple of three or four things that quickly come to my mind. I can't tell you how many times people have asked me, who replaced Ralph Sampson? And I say, I did. What do you mean? I said, because when Terry Holland called me and offered me the job and the chance to come to the University of Virginia, I said, I don't know where I'm going to live. I hadn't sold my house where I am. He said, don't worry about it. You can take Ralph's spot. He's been in our house 3 years. It's time for him to go. So he and Ann took me in until we could sell our house and get my family down here. And then he made it possible for us to buy two houses down from him on Mars Road. That was a very important thing to me, to be invited into a man's home without him really knowing who I was or who I was going to turn out to be, let alone my family. And I think Ralph said it very, very well when he talked about UVA as a, if anything, UVA is a great family. It's a community of faith that we're all netted together. And it really started when Terry Holland was named head basketball coach here, and it just continued through the years. People ask me what he taught quickly. He taught me the value of passing and catching the ball. I didn't know that when I came here. I know it now. He taught me the value of toughness at the half-court level. I see a lot of those guys that we coached back in those days that maybe didn't have the kind of ability that Ralph had, but they could play for him because they had big chests and a willing heart. And he taught me that. And I tried to continue that as we went along. And I will say this to you, we live two doors apart up there on Marsh Road. I went by there today, and you know, there's a ton of memories there. My proudest day as a UVA assistant basketball coach was any day that we played a basketball team, particularly on those Sunday afternoons or Saturday afternoons when Louisville came to town, or North Carolina came to town, or Duke, or whoever it happens to be. They were all big games. And I would go out of my front porch, and I would take a left, and I'd go and stand in front of Terry and Ann's house, and I would wait for him to come out of there. And together we would walk down to, what was that, Alderman Road, and we'd take a left, and we walk across the bridge, and it's about 2.5 hours before game time. And the fans, but the students are starting to pile their way down there. And as we walk across that trestle line, I can hear them saying, kick their ass, coach. That was one of my proudest days ever. And it was proud because I knew we could, but it was prouder because I was walking with my good friend. And
we're sitting here in this wonderful building. We're sitting here with Tony Bennett, who has the weight of every expectation in the world on his shoulders and the shoulders of his team. It wasn't always so at the University of Virginia. Somebody had to show the people here that it was possible. Somebody had to help them imagine it. There's nobody who is more responsible for that than Coach Holland. Now, somebody who isn't here, who played for Coach Holland, made a great effort to call me, and he had something that he wanted me to say, and that was John Crotty. John Crotty, he said that he wanted me to say something, so he sent me some bullet points. He wanted me to say this about Coach Holland. I remember that he was a great foot stomper, especially when yelling at the officials. I remember him wearing his gorilla suit, jumping out at people trying to scare them. I remember him as a true Southern gentleman who always made me take my hat off indoors. But mainly, I remember him changing us into men. I just want him to know how much I appreciate him and the impact he had on my life. Coach, anybody who ever played for you feels the same way. Thank you very much. Now we got Coach Page back up here again. How about a round of applause for Dan Bonner? Dan, thank you very much. Okay, we're coming down the home stretch. Do we have time for one more story?
Yes.
You all know what a great sense of humor, practical joker that this man is, okay? September of 1976, I had just joined the basketball staff, and as a reward for the team having won the ACC championship the year before, Mr. Corrigan set it up so that the entire basketball staff could accompany the football team in the season opening football game at the University of Washington. My first experience with Mike Shuler and Terry and the staff, it was a great opportunity. So we're out in Seattle, 1976. We're spending about 3 or 4 days out there. And in the days leading up to the football game, Terry and Ann and Mike and his family, we're all, John Gordon, we're touring around Seattle. And at that time, Seattle was a bustling, dynamic, progressive place, ethnicities of people from all over the globe. So we were one afternoon riding on a public bus, and it's the Virginia staff seated on one side of the bus, and on the other side, a number of the locals. And Terry, who knows a little bit about everything, was telling us over and over during the course of this trip about Samoans and how there are so many Samoans in Seattle, Washington, and we learned more about Samoans from Terry than we had reading history books, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, there's a guy sitting across the aisle from us, and Terry is staring at him, and he's saying, this guy's a Samoan, Page. So finally, after a couple of minutes, he's staring at the guy, and now the guy is staring back at him. And Terry looks at him and says, "By the way, are you a Samoan?" And the guy, deadpan, looks back at him and says, "No, are you?" But we had a great time, and that was just a snapshot of, in addition to the great coaching that he did, the impact that he's had on people, not only on his players, the impact that he has had on this community and the Commonwealth of Virginia has been phenomenal. So we're going to have one person come up to introduce Terry, who we're going to give an opportunity to speak. And this is the voice of the Cavaliers from the 75-76 ACC championship season. He is a Hall of Fame broadcaster in his own right. Hall of Fame broadcaster, formerly of the Minnesota Twins, Mr. John Gordon Gutowski. John, thank you.
This was not set up for short, guys. Thank you, Craig. It is indeed an honor to be here tonight. If I may, for just a brief moment. Walker from the baseline, 22-footer, bingo! Wonder for Wally with 22, and the Cavaliers have the lead 52-46 over the Carolina Tar Heels. Wow, what a game we got going here tonight. 10 minutes and 22 seconds to go. Hang on to your armchair, Grandpa. We got a barn burner going here tonight. Thank you very much for allowing me that opportunity. That brought back a big memory for me in that 75-76 season. Some of the pundits called the success of the 75-76 season magical. And then there were others that relayed the success of the Virginia Cavaliers and said that winning the AC championship was nothing more short of being a miracle. Magical, miracle, they both fit. But there was one guy during the course of that season that remained calm, cool, and collected throughout the entire process. His name was head coach Terry Holland. You wonder if Terry, as he watched some of his players at times trip over their own feet, that maybe perhaps he would have a belly laugh or even a smile. And then he also wondered, as Terry tried to see his team grasp a coaching concept, and time after time they couldn't get it, that Terry might even shout out an expletive to his team. Actually, shout one out, not Terry Holland. Calm, cool, and collected. We were in Durham, North Carolina, preparing for an ACC championship battle against the Duke Blue Devils. Time for everybody on the team traveling party to get on the bus and go to Camden Indoor. 5:45, and Terry knocked on the door and said, "Come on, JG, it's time to go." I said, "T, hang on for just a moment. I'm watching a classic Andy Griffin show right now where Andy is trying to see if he can get Barney out of jail." Terry says, "Come on with me, let's go." He says, "I can tell you the rest of that story." Now here's a guy trying to get ready for an ACC battle against the Duke Blue Devils, wondering whether or not he has to full court press or do something maybe to box out the big man underneath. And he's talking about Andy Griffin trying to get Barney out of jail. Calm, cool, and collected, Terry Holland, coach of the 75-76 Atlantic Coast Conference champion basketball team. Ladies and gentlemen, here he is. Come on up, Terry.
Thank you. Of course, thinking back to that ACC tournament, one of the things that bothered me a great deal was the fact that we had to play three games to win the championship, and North Carolina only had to play two games. Now, that doesn't sound right to me for some reason, but they had a bye that year. They were a great basketball team, and they'd earned the bye, so we had to figure out a way to beat them three games. And the first, those three games were played in a total of 48 hours to give you how tough it was to come back. The first game against Maryland, we felt very good, against NC State. We felt very good about playing them because they were not as tough defensively as we were. So we played great defense in that game. We took a 16-point lead in the first half and we coasted into the next round. The next round was Maryland, though. My old coach, Lefty Drizel. We're gonna go head to head against another team. We were 0-6 against NC State that year. We were 0-6 against Maryland. But we were convinced we were the best team in the tournament. That for the 40 minutes and 120 minutes of three games of 40 minutes, that we had the ability to stay with it longer than the competition did. Maryland had three great guards, very fast. So now not only are we playing a team that has a lot more depth than we have, but they have more speed, so they want us to play fast. We played another great game. Then we got to play Carolina. And it's time to leave our hotel. And we turn around and Frank Burkhead runs into the coach's meeting. Frank says, "Coach, the car keys are gone." We drove state cars all around at that time. So we had five cars assigned to us and all the keys were now gone. The alumni who were in the same hotel were getting ready to leave to go to the game. We're like, Frank Burkhead is panicked. He doesn't know what to do. We said, "Go back and look in your room again." He did it. He came back. He said, "No, they're not there. I know they're not there." He goes back to the room again, and the keys have magically reappeared. But the meal money for the players has disappeared. So Frank is again, he's going crazy. How could this be? Now, we still don't know who did that, who got those keys, and who returned them. But I do know this. It got our mind off of having to play Carolina right away. It allowed us to have a brief respite before we geared up again. because all the players were having a lot of fun with it and teasing Frank. But we got the money back. We passed it out to the players, and we went after the championship. Of course, you saw some of the tape. You saw some of it in person. But I do believe that that set a tone for what Virginia could be. Now, we were not able to repeat that the next year, but we came daggone close. I mean, we really had a chance at that game as well. We just ran out of gas because we were like 22 for 24 from the free throw line late in the game. But we were just so tired after that. Carolina kept fouling us, and we only went 2 for 8 the rest of that game. So, you know, we ended up allowing them to slip back in. But the real thing about it is Virginia basketball is not one team, that one that won the championship. It's about a lot of great things going on every single day. And these young men put their hearts and souls on the line for us. We've been fortunate to have great coaches. Dave Odom's one. He went on to coach in the ACC at Wake Forest against us. He also was named 3-time ACC Coach of the Year. Seth Greenberg was only with us for a brief time period as an assistant coach, but he went on to Virginia Tech and coached there and was a 2-time ACC Coach of the Year. So we've had great people here, great people who have been able to make things happen. Our best recruiter has always been my wife, Ann. The rest of us did all we could, but when it came down to what do we have to do to get Ralph, she was the one who would come up with the ideas. She did a great job. She cooked. When we had players over on the recruiting trail, she did everything you can possibly imagine to make it, they make them understand that they were going to be family members. Rick Carlisle used to come to our house on a regular basis and play the piano. Now, unfortunately, he only knew one song. He played that over and over until the kids started going to bed with plugs in their ears so that they could get a little sleep. But they loved Rick. I mean, you know, they would have stayed there all night if we'd have let them. But that's the kind of program we wanted to have here, and that's the one we did. Yeah, we were very intense at times. We did everything we could to provide the great people who make up the Virginia Basketball Club. Think about what you guys have been to us. And I'd like to ask those who have been members of the Virginia Basketball Club or donors to athletics to please stand up, because you're what it's all about. You're the reason we do these things. You're the reason we accomplish those things. The great thing about basketball, it is the greatest team game. And nobody, the head coach or assistant coach or the best player on the team, could win without their teammates. And that's one of the values that I do think playing basketball brings to the table. So we are very fortunate to have someone like Tony Bennett coaching our basketball team. What a wonderful, human being, and what a great basketball coach he is, and how fortunate we are, and what do we have to do to keep him here? And it probably doesn't mean a lot. It means we need to treat him like he is one of the best that ever coached the game. He certainly is. So we're very fortunate I'd like to say that, you know, we're going to be supportive of everything that he does, and I know the people in this room are going to be as well. It's been a wonderful ride for the Holland family to be part of this. We're happy to be here tonight, obviously, but the main thing is we want to be around for a while and see as many of those games as we possibly can. So should we sing the good old days of Wahoo Wah, or how should we wrap this up tonight? I think we should just say we got a lot more to do and we're going to get it done. How about that? Can everybody say that?
Let's have a round of applause, Coach Terry Holland. Let me close with just a couple of remarks. I want to thank our panelists, Dave, Rick, Ralph, Wally, not only what you've done tonight, but what you've done for this program. Thank you very much. Thank you to John Gordon for being here and for that special introduction of Terry. Dan Bonner, for you hosting our panel. Coach Bennett, all of our coaches. Tom Perrin wasn't recognized among our coaches that are here. Tom Perrin is here, but so many of our former players. We thank each and every one of you. All of you as our fans, our supporters, the believers in this program. But most of all, this is a night to be able to thank Terry and Ann Holland and the Holland family for what they've done for the University of Virginia and Virginia basketball. One more round of applause, if you will.